Very warm welcome to our service. And a special welcome to our visitors. Good to see Stuart with us for the first time over from Jura. So welcome, Stuart. Before we begin our worship of God, Ian will give us the notices coming week.
Our service
for
today is
the
beloved Reverend Alex Stuart. The evening service is at the usual time of 6:30 p.m. The afternoon service in Belfort, monthly afternoon service in Belfort is at 3 p.m. And I'll be taking that. Monday we have Zero Stress at 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and Road to Recovery in the evening at 7:30 p.m. Tuesday is a quiet day and Wednesday we have prayer meeting at 7:30. Thursday again is a quiet day. And on Friday, we can drop in the cafe at 11 a.m. and Eastern Bartonshire and food bank at the same time. That's going until 1 p.m. Christianity Explored at 1:30. So then we have the Saturdays again at 9:30. The next Lord's Day, the service is at the usual times of 11 a.m. and 6:30 p.m. And both services will be conducted by myself, Alec is heading north. So please, if you remain behind for a cup of tea, that's fine, and, or you can partake of a bowl of soup. That's us.
Thank you, Ian. And with that, we're going to worship God by singing to His praise. In Psalm 138, we're going to sing from the Scottish Psalter on page 431, verses 1 to the end of verse mark 8. Thee will I praise with all my heart. I will sing praise to thee before the gods and worship will toward thy sanctuary. Down to the end of verse 8. Surely that which concerneth me, the Lord will perfect me. Lord, still thy mercy's love, do not thy own hand's work forsake. Sing this to the praise of God, thee will I praise with all my heart.
Thee will I praise with all my heart. I will sing praise. I'll praise thy name, for thy
you to bless us this morning. We do ask, O Lord, that you would come and lead us in this service, Lord. We pray for the guidance and blessing of your Holy Spirit. We thank you, Lord, and praise you that you are God, our Father, and that you are the Lord, that you are exalted, you are high and lifted up. You are sovereign over creation, and you, in your providence, care for your creatures. And Lord, you who have brought everything into being through the word of your power, you sustain all things and uphold all things through your word of power. We rejoice in that wonderful truth today, Lord, the amazing truth of it is something that we don't understand, but we receive by faith, Lord. We truly praise you, Lord, that you are the God whose ways are past finding out. And yet, Lord, we thank you that although eye has not seen, ear hath not heard, nor hath entered into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for those who love him, you have revealed them to us, Lord, in measure through your Spirit. And we rejoice in that truth today, Lord, that we have your word and Spirit, and that, Lord, you are continually revealing yourself and your plans for our lives, Lord, bit by bit. We thank you, Lord, that you know the beginning from the end. You have revealed your plan for creation, Lord. And we rejoice in the truth, Lord, that Jesus Christ has won the glorious victory for us through his incarnation, his perfect life, his death, his resurrection, and his exaltation. And we rejoice this morning, Lord, that he will return one day to judge the living and the dead. We thank you, Lord, that that day he will gather his people. We thank you, Lord, that we can look forward to that with hearts that are blessed, Lord, knowing that there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ. But we pray, Lord, that we would work out our salvation in this life, Lord, with fear and trembling, that we would, Lord, be diligent to make our calling and election sure. We thank you, Lord, that in the councils of eternity, our election and calling is sure. But yet, Lord, we pray that we would live in such a way that we would produce the fruit of the Spirit, that we would allow your Spirit to work in us and through us, that we might be a blessing to others, Lord. And our gracious God, we confess this morning that often, Lord, we sin and we are found, Lord, in so many ways to fall short. And we confess our sins to you, Lord. And we pray this morning, Lord, that you would cleanse us afresh. We thank you for the wonderful truth of the gospel, that the blood of Jesus Christ, God's Son, cleanses us from all sin, and we have fellowship with each other, one with the other. We thank you this morning, Lord, that your word is being declared to the ends of the earth, and we pray that it would, Lord, accomplish what you have purposed. We pray this morning, Lord, that for every pulpit in the land, that you would accompany the word with your Spirit, Lord. And that, Lord, you would work in the hearts of your people to bless them and to bring the word they need, Lord, for their particular situation and their particular issues, Lord. We pray for those, Lord, who have not yet surrendered their hearts and lives to you, Lord, that this day, Lord, that you would draw them to yourself, that there would be a wonderful addition to the church, that we would everywhere throughout the world, Lord, that you, according to your word, would add daily such as should be saved, that there would be joy in the presence of the angels today, Lord. We thank you that the kingdom of God is advancing, Lord. And we pray for it in the United Kingdom, in this community. You know the needs of this community, Lord, the difficulties facing the residents and the young, the old, the children, Lord. We pray that you would meet every home, every family, every individual according to their particular need, Lord, and that, Father, you would bring salvation. We remember, Lord, the international issues, Lord. We think of China and the coronavirus, Lord. We ask, Father, that you would bring a resolution, that you would bring healing, that you would bring comfort and hope to the Chinese people, and that, Lord, you would provide them with the help they need from the international community, Lord, and that there would be a gathering together to work to solve this issue that is so desperate, Lord. We remember the families of those who have lost loved ones. We pray you would be with them, Lord, and to strengthen them and help them at this time, Lord, when they are perhaps bewildered and confused, to look to you and to look, Lord, for the strength and hope that you can bring. Thank you that you brought Amy safely home to us, Lord. And we thank you, Lord, for her studies, and we thank you for all the young folk. We remember Angus, Lord, in his studies, that you would continue to bless them and their friends, Lord. And Father, we do remember the sick in our congregation. We remember Katrina, Lord, and Susan, and we remember Nora, Lord. We ask, Father, that you would minister to them according to their needs today, that you would bring a measure of strength and healing. And there are so many, Lord, with colds and coughs and sniffles, Lord. We pray, Father, that you would really just move in the situation to bring healing and to bring strengthening to every individual and family, Lord. We remember Katrina, Lord, as she visits her granddaughter, Beth. We pray for Katrina, Lord, to be strengthened and Beth to be restored, Lord, as she's come down with another infection. Look after her, Lord, and bring healing and wholeness to her. We do remember others, Lord, who are ill. We remember Sheila and Tracy, Father God, we commit them to you, that you would bring healing and strength, consolation and comfort to them and their families, Lord. And our gracious God, we do commit the work of the gospel here in Leinstown to you, Lord, that it would flourish, blossom, bear fruit, Lord. And Father, we think of those who are not with us today. We remember Christine in hospital, Lord, that she too, Lord, she's getting out today, but we pray, Lord, that her improvement would continue and that she'd be strengthened. We remember Jill, Lord, take care of her where she is and give her the help that she needs. We do thank you for Nan, Lord, and the way you have looked after her and strengthened her and helped her, Lord, in her recovery. It's been a long process, but we thank you for it, Lord, and we thank you for her family, Lord, and we pray that Eric and Diane in days to come, Lord, would know much of your grace, Lord, and help in helping them to come apart a while by themselves, that they would rest in your grace, Lord, and know your restoration for their weary souls, Lord. So, Father, bless this service. We pray, Lord, that you would take the things of God in Christ, make them known to us. We pray, Father, that you would open hearts and minds to hear you and see you today, Lord. And, Lord, that you would lead us into your truth by your Spirit, because you have promised that you would, Lord. And, Father, when all is said and done, we pray that you would have all the praise, honor, and glory, and that we could acknowledge that it was good for us to have been together here this morning. We do pray, Father, that you would forgive us for all our many sins. We ask for all these things in Jesus' name. Let us sing. Amen.
Amen.
We're going to sing our first hymn now, which is a lovely hymn. I heard the voice of Jesus say, come unto me and rest. Lay down thy weary one. Lay down thy head upon my breast. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, you are my son, today I have begotten you. As he says also in another place, you are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death when he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience to what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. About this, we have much to say, and it is hard to explain, since you have become dull of hearing. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature, for those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. Amen. And we pray the Lord would bless that reading of his own precious and holy word, and to his own name be honor, praise, and glory. We'll sing once again from Psalm 119 this time, and at verse 9, that's on page 400 from the Scottish Psalter, Psalm 119, verse 9. By what means shall a young man learn his way to purify, if he according to thy word thereto attentive be? To the end of verse 16, upon thy statutes my delight shall constantly be fed, and by thy grace I never will thy holy word forget. We'll sing these verses to God's praise. By what means shall a young man live?
By what means shall a young man learn his way to purify, if he according to thy word thereto attentive be?
Encourage us, strengthen us, restore us. Teach us your ways, Lord. Help us to understand, Lord. And we pray, Father, when we go from here, we can truly acknowledge that it was good to us to have been together. May your name be praised and glorified. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Well, we're coming to the last part of this chapter. And as I was looking at this, I realized that there were some things in my life that I had to go and revise and look at again. And it's because I wasn't applying myself in the way I should have been. Because I had time off. And I said, well, time off, we don't need to be looking at these things. And of course, when you don't look at things, you tend to forget them. And so you have to go back to the beginning. And this is a very serious matter if it's the Word of God. The writer to the Hebrews has just been talking about Christ's high priesthood, and he explains that he's been now a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. But he's got a teaching to make on this. And he says, I've got a lot to say, but it's hard to explain because you become dull of hearing. Because it's such an important subject, the writer goes on to speak about it in the following chapters, especially chapter 7. And he says, by this time you ought to be teachers, but you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. For everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child. But solid food is for the mature. For those who have their powers of discernment trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. So he's really speaking about being constantly in the Word of God. And he rebukes the Jews, here the readers of the letter, the Hebrews, and he rebukes them for their spiritual immaturity. And there's four things that we can pick up here. He rebuked them. They were rebuked for their lack of listening. They were rebuked for their lack of learning. They were rebuked for their lack of effectiveness. And they were rebuked for their lack of spiritual growth. So we can go back to chapter 2. And here he speaks about listening and paying attention. And he ends this section in 5 with the same thing. He paused to consider the theological understanding and the moral condition of the readers, and he expressed a concern that they may not understand these doctrines he was explaining. And he said about this, and of course the subject is about Christ, the high priest. And the subject is of Christ is prefigured by Melchizedek, who was the king of Salem. And it really means the king of righteousness, Melchizedek, and who was the king of Salem, the king of righteousness, and the king of peace. That's what his name and what his territory meant. And this is not an issue with communication, like the language. If we went to another country, we would struggle with a language issue. But it's a barrier caused by the lack of spiritual awareness. Much to say, the writer wants to give them a greater insight into how Jesus is a priest after the order of Melchizedek. And it is hard to explain. They have lost their appetite for Christian truth. And he wants to stir them up to to look at their lives and the Word of God to prepare their hearts for his teaching on Melchizedek in the following chapter. And, you know, it's a wonderful prayer to come to church with and ask God to prepare our hearts to receive his truth, because we need our hearts to be prepared. I remember a guy said to me, and in England I was preaching in Southampton, and he said to me, I was up in the Highlands, and he said, I went into the Free Church, and he thought it was really funny that there was a Gaelic service and an English service, and he said nobody was talking as they were waiting for the minister. And he thought this was a big joke. And I said, well, maybe they were preparing their heart to receive the Word of God. And that's what they were doing. And I was reminded about that this morning. I need to prepare my heart to receive the Word of God. And you need to prepare your heart to receive the Word of God. But these Hebrews, rather than giving their hearts and minds to Christian doctrine and teaching and the Word of God, they have become Delotean, he says. And the word del carries the meaning of become sluggish. And you'll notice they have become sluggish. So there is a suggestion that they have not previously been this sluggish. They have become sluggish in receiving the Word of God. And the word nothrag, it actually means lazy with respect to hearing. Sluggish in hearing, slow to learn, and even translated, you no longer try to understand. The people became this way through hardening their hearts to the truth and through being disinterested in the truth. There was the warning that they were drifting away in chapter 2. So the sluggishness in receiving the word was not because they did not have the word. The word was there for them. They just did not have the heart to put much effort into studying the word of God or to understand it and practicing the word. If a message was kind of deep or difficult, they would let it pass them by. Now, have you ever tried to feed a little child? Pretty sure we've all done it. Looking at Eric and Diana, who store food in their mouths and are trying all the moves to get them to eat their food. And they would swallow, they store it in their mouth like a hamster. And then they spit it out. And some little children love food that can be easily swallowed without any chewing. And children like that kind of food, you know, they like these little puddings and stuff they can, it's almost liquidized. And they'll take as much as they can. But anything they have to chew and work on, they'll spit it out and it will be wasted. And this is something that perhaps could apply to these Hebrew readers. They had a negligent attitude with the Word of God. This Word of God was to feed them, but they weren't masticating it, they weren't chewing it, they weren't digesting it. They might have been great people in other ways, but they were lazy when it came to a systematic study of the Word of God and in listening to it and its relevance in their lives. So they were rebuked for a lack of listening, and they were rebuked for a lack of learning. See what the writer says here. This is really powerful. For though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you again the basic principles of the oracles of God. You need milk, not solid food. Because they did not spend time investing in a study of the Word of God or seeking God to help them understand, they had to be taught again. They had been under the Word for so long They themselves should have been able to teach, but they have to be taught again. Now, this doesn't necessarily mean that they should have been in the ministry of teaching, but it means they should have been able to teach the Word of God to others in everyday life. But rather, they needed to be taught the basic principles of the Word of God. Now, we might ask, what are these basic principles? And we have the Greek word stoikeo, and it means one of a row. That's the word used for basic principles. Letters of the alphabet. That's basically what it's saying. You need to learn your ABCs, the elementary part of the words. Those Christians had heard enough Christian teachings in their lifetime that would have qualified them to teach others, but rather than teaching others, they were still going A, B, C, D, E, F, G. Oracles of God does not refer to the gospel. Now, the original, in its context here, the original readers of the Hebrews were Jews, and to them, the oracles of God was the Old Testament. The oracles of God were the law, the prophets, and the writings, which was the Psalms and the wisdom literature. The Jews had been entrusted with God's oracles, and it was for them a great advantage, Paul said in Romans 3:12. It was God's revelation. They were privileged, the law. And it was these Jews that needed to be taught again. They had been taught, but they needed to be taught again. They had been taught the Old Covenant, they had been taught about the New Covenant, but they did not even understand the Old Covenant. This is shown by the fact that they could not handle the deeper truth of Melchizedek and how he prefigured Christ. Not only are they not able to teach, these Jews must go back to primary school, the school of faith, to learn first principles. Now, we know that children often learn by pictures. You know, I think I like visuals, I learn visually, which people, some learn by listening and hearing, others learn by seeing things, others learn by doing things. There's various ways to learn, and especially in the Word of God, you know, it's hearing. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. But with children, you know, they like to see a picture, and you ask them, what's that picture? It's a car. What's that picture? It's a mouse. And they can associate things with pictures. We learned in primary school by learning, we had a book, I'm not sure how many remember this book, but we used to call it the Arthur Apple. Don't know if anyone ever had that. Arthur Apple, Infernino, Kipperham. And of course they had all these pictures and the letters beside them. And that's the way we learned the letters. Now, the Old Testament is a book of shadows. The tabernacle is a book of shadows. It's pictures that point to a greater reality. They pointed to Christ. But these Jews had to be taught this again. Paul said in Galatians 3:24 that the law was a schoolmaster to lead us to Christ. And it's translated various ways. So then the law, Paul said, was our guardian until Christ came, in order that we might be justified by faith. And the word used for guardian is pedagogos, and it's also translated tutor or schoolmaster. Now, pedagogos was a guardian for children who taught them and helped them. And he was more than a teacher. He instructed them in everything until such time as the children were able to take responsibility for themselves. And in this way, the Old Testament law taught us and pointed us and guided us and leads us to Christ. But they had not learned the ABCs. Lack of listening and of learning had led to a lack of effectiveness in their Christian life, and they were rebuked for this. They had become ineffective. They were not making a positive impact on any new convert to the Christian faith. And the readers of this letter had come back in the Christian life. And that's really never, ever good, because standing still in the Christian life is no use, because standing still will lead to going back. We must continually be going forward. They have drifted back from where they were. These Christians should have been offering the word of God to others. Rather than offering help to others, they were in need of help themselves. They were experiencing a lack of effectiveness in the Christian life because they had become dull and lazy. And we said this goes back to chapter 2, where they had not, where he tells them to pay attention and not to neglect the great salvation. And the word ought, you know, you ought, suggests that they had failed in their duty. They ought to have been teachers. It doesn't say they might have been teachers. You ought, he said, to have been teachers. There were others around them who needed what they had, should have been able to offer, but rather than offering anything to anyone, they were in need of their ABCs and to be fed milk rather than solid food. And the writer says, for everyone who lives on milk is unskilled in the word of righteousness, since he is a child, but solid food is for the mature. For those who have the powers of discernment, trained by constant practice to distinguish good from evil. So being constantly in the word of God helps us. Lack of listening, lack of learning, and lack of effectiveness had led to a lack of growth. Here, at the end of chapter 5, the writer is seen explaining why his readers were suffering from laziness and lack of effectiveness. They are babies. That was the problem. They were babies. The problem is they are still babies. You can't really expect a baby to put time and effort into systematic study of the Word of God. Could you seriously expect a baby to teach others? Now, a baby has got no desire for that. But babes are curious and inquisitive, and they are always looking, listening, and learning. If you've ever babysat your children or spent some time with them, which I'm sure you have, somehow those Hebrews had become lethargic, lazy, and dull. Now, my uncle said to me, he said, you know, if you see a child, he said, sitting clean and tidy and not doing anything, there's something wrong. And he's right, you know. Children are, they're not forcing, like still and lethargic or dull. So a baby needs both proper feeding and proper exercise. And that also includes proper engagement with others and with the environment. That's how children develop their skills, their social skills, their learning skills, with interaction and engagement. This is vital to adequate growth and development. If a baby was kept from the world, it could not engage with the world, and that baby would somehow be stunted in its psychological, emotional, social, and spiritual development. The contrast here is simple. The one who continues to feed on only on God's elementary revelations is not going to grow. It's not going to have any discernment. A little child will automatically try and grab anything they can reach. Have you ever noticed that? Well, you're always taking things from them. they go anywhere they manage to crawl. They constantly try and pick things up, and automatically, with no concept of whether it is good or bad or even dangerous, pick things up and straight away they want to eat it, don't they? It could be poison, it doesn't matter to them. They haven't learned. The mature adult, on the other hand, has developed discernment. She is careful about what she eats, what she does, where she goes. Discernment about what is right, wrong, true and false, safe and dangerous. The Word of God trains us in all these things. Trains us in righteousness and in wisdom. And that is why we need to feed on the Word of God, and we need to swallow it and digest it. We see from these verses that it's not a problem with drinking milk, because milk nourishes the body. We know back many years ago there was a problem with children developing rickets because of a lack of calcium. And we grew up in a time when we were all called into the canteen at, I think it was about 3 o'clock before we went home, and we all got a third of a pint of milk in a little bottle, and we had this every day. We looked forward to it, and being children, we were very creative. We all saved our straws, and we made wonderful art projects with them. The milk was beneficial to us physically, and it also gave us an opportunity to develop our skills in creativity. And Margaret Thatcher became infamous for taking the milk away from school children, and she earned the Nomer Thatcher the Snatcher. And I remember over 20 years ago speaking to my farmer friend. He told me every week at the nearby dairy farm, gallons of milk were poured away to satisfy EU market regulatory demands. You know, I think our children could teach us a lot. The problem, water, water all around and not a drop to drink, seems strange. The problem here for these people, though, were drinking milk without eating solid food. Milk is only for the little baby, but it's not only for the little baby, because adults can take milk as well. But adults shouldn't live on just milk. But as babies mature, they also progress to solid food. Not only are they mature, those who eat solid food, they also are those who exercise what they eat. The word train is translated get in masamena, which we get the word gymnasium from. No one goes to the gymnasium to walk around, do they? It's designed for exercise. It's designed for practice and competing and developing. And that's what the Word of God does. It's to help us develop our spiritual maturity, spiritual muscles, if you like. And it's for the day of the big competition. And you know, the Word of God will help you to stand in the day of evil. You know, sometimes there's a day when everything comes against you. And that's the day that you need the Word of God. You need the Word of God every day. But on that particular day, you realize how important being trained in the Word of God is. If there is no adequate training, there can be no practice, and there will not be an adequate result. The readers of the Hebrews did not intend to be where they were in their Christian growth. They had gradually drifted to this low standard of living because of their attitude towards Christian learning, and now they were in danger. When there is a lack of understanding of the primacy of the Word of God and the need for the Word of God, there will develop a lack of desire for it. For those who think they do not need the word of God. Well, we have to revisit the power of the word of God and the promises of the word of God. The pictures and types of Judaism were to train them and to point them to the Lord Jesus Christ. And they are to leave these pictures, but they're not to forget them. I have to go back to some basics in something I was doing because I didn't spend time on it. We're not to forget these pictures, but we are to associate them and incorporate them into our learning. We're to focus on the reality of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we are to focus on his love and grace, his death and resurrection for us, and the fact that he's exalted at the right hand of God as our high priest. He's the only Savior, and he is the judge as well, and he will return one day to judge the living and the dead. And for those of us who are trusting Jesus today, the judge is our Savior. So if we've learned one thing today, we pray that it is that as we trust Jesus, we can know there is no condemnation. But as we trust Jesus, help us, we pray, Lord, to grow in grace and in knowledge of him. So they were rebuked for their spiritual immaturity, their lack of listening, rebuked for their lack of learning, they were rebuked for their lack of effectiveness, and they were rebuked for their lack of faith. May the Lord bless his word to us. We'll sing our final hymn, which is this beautiful hymn, "What a Wonderful Change in My Life Has Been Wrought Since Jesus Came Into My Heart."
Jesus came into
that we have known in our Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you for your precious Son. We thank you for your precious Word, your precious Spirit, the gift you have given us, Lord. And we pray that this day, Lord, you would part us with your blessing. We do pray that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit would rest upon you and remain upon you and all whom you love, now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Please wait for a cup of tea if you can.